for the molecular communications. You know, the as for any kind of communications, the simple yet sufficiently accurate channel models are needed for the design, the analysis, and efficient operation of the molecular communication systems. So I think, please, I think when we had started learning some RF communications, wireless communications, long time ago, we first learned the additive white Gaussian noise channels and several fading channels like Rayleigh fading, Roentgen fading, and some other sophisticated channel models. So here, I'd like to introduce some noble channel models for the molecular communications. So here is a very basic figure for the communications. So the arrival molecules in molecular communication via the diffusion, it always by its nature the binomial distribution. Considering the hitting probability as the success probability. You know, the binomial distribution with the parameters sometimes N and P is the discrete probability distribution of the number of successes in a sequence of N independent experiments. It's asking, for example, yes, no question. And each with its own Boolean value outcome, like the yes or no. For example, success with probability P, or failure with probability Q. Q is like here, 1 minus P. A single, the success-failure experiment is also called the Bernoulli trial. We all know that, or the Bernoulli experiment. And a sequence of the outcomes is called the Bernoulli process. And you know, the binomial distribution, I mean, is the Bernoulli distribution, like the for a single trial when we have the n equals 1. So very basic mathematics behind. So let me remind the system model here. The information is modulated via emitted the molecules. Here, following the emission, the molecule diffuse in aqueous, like the some water or gas or liquid and fluid, anything, the environment, and arrived at the receiver in a probabilistic manner. The receiver nodes counts the number of the molecules and demodulates the information. So the signal detection can be done by like a thresholding the number of received molecules. We will study the detection algorithm later, so don't worry about that if you don't understand that one at this moment. So the number of the received molecules in a predetermined duration, because we pick the some certain duration and symbol period or symbol interval. And this is the random variable, and we focus on the underlying model for the arrival process. Here, in a 3D medium, you know, the expected the fraction of molecules observed by the receiver nodes till time t is given like that this equation. It has the complementary error function inside, and rr is the radius of this the receiver part, and this is the distance between the transmitter and receiver, and here D is the diffusion coefficient, and T is, of course, the time variable. So by using the equation I showed just before, the symbol duration here, Ts, and the number of the released molecules here, and Tx, and we could divide the expected number of the received molecules between T1 and T1 plus Ts. Which is denoted by like the NRX here, this parameter. So we know that the mean number, the average number of this the arriving molecules from the equation here. And while the around this mean, an instance of the signal fluctuates a lot here. We also have the some random movement. So considering the hitting of the molecules to the receiver is a success event to suggest modeling the arrival as binomial process, as I already explained before. So therefore, we could also model the number of received molecules between T1 and T1 plus TS, like the second equation. So here, B, that stands for the binomial distribution. Here, with NTX trials and success probability, and the second part here. So during the communications, we don't have just a single shot transmission. So conjunctive bits are sent via the molecular diffusion channel here. So therefore, we need to sum the effect of the previously sent molecules for the current symbol duration. The binomial model, however, is intractable. It's not that simple for analytical some derivations. And also, it's not so easy to manipulate. So this model is mostly approximated by the Poisson or Gaussian model. But the question is that here, that which approximation is more accurate under the which conditions? That is the question. So we can use Poisson approximation, or we can use Gaussian approximation for when? We need the boundary. So to have the answer to that question, so we simulated the molecular communication system very extensively with a point source and an observing receiver. That's the closed form expression. That's why we assume that the system setups and the setting. And we also recorded the NRX number of the received molecular values. So in the figure on the left side here, the left side, that one, and we analyzed the effect of NTX as a function of the number of the transmit molecules on the RMSE between the CDF of the simulation and CDF of the model. So the binomial, the model has the the binomial model has the smallest the RMSE values, of course, as we could expect it, and the Poisson model is nearly stable. Poisson is like here, nearly stable, and the RMSE of the Gaussian model improves as NX increases. So increasing NTX results in a higher mean number of arriving molecules. That's because the effect of the problematic part of the Gaussian model diminishes, like negative values. So from the figure on the left and the right side, we can see which model is better for a given parameters. The thicker contour corresponds to like a level jitter, and the right side of the jitter level is the better for the Poisson model. And the dashed line corresponds to the analytical solution for an estimate of the RMSE difference. So here we have to successfully derive the closed form expressions for the switching part, the switching expressions between two approximations. I don't include that equation here in this slide, and you can find that one as well from the our paper. So we expect that this research gives the some guidelines for the system designers to optimize how many molecules I should use, without relying on the feedback from a receiver. So that is the one of our the contribution. And this is the quite simple, some mathematical intuition to have some analytical solutions for analyzing system the performance. So you know the one of the attractive areas we could use the molecular communication is the as I mentioned yesterday, the Internet of Bio Nano Things. So we focused on the health monitoring system and consisting of the scattered bio nano things inside the blood vessel. So far, we assume like the free space diffusive channels. There's no boundary. There is no like a flow or some drift velocity. And here, for the other bio applications, we have the different channels, which means we need the different channel models. So here, this system exploits the blood vessels as molecular communication channels. So it requires this distinct channel model, as I mentioned, and the most existing studies on molecular communication have focused on the free space diffusive channel. So spatial restrictions and the drift present here in the blood vessels are the main differences compared to the free space diffusive channel. And the spatial limitations can be approximated by the cylindrical duct shape. So we empirically showed that the blood vessel channels introduce a new set of challenges for the molecular communication system design compared to the free space channel. So we then next propose cylindrical duct channel models. And we discussed the corresponding system design and conforming to the channel characteristics in our the one of the papers. So based on the prototype implementation, which we'll introduce the maybe next week, and we also confirmed that the molecular communication techniques can be a reliable and energy effective solutions for exchanging data that generated from the internal organs to the outside world. So here on the right side, we illustrate the difference between the channel responses of the cylindrical duct channel and the free space channel. So for the free space channel, we do have the nice closed form expressions, and we do not need to run very happy Monte Carlo simulations to have these channel responses. Here, the cylindrical duct channel is a higher the signal amplitude than a free space channel, which means that the channel is more directional. That's quite obvious, right? Because we have some bounds to the upside and downside, and we only have the one-way direction. That's why we have the higher directional gain to the right side, this part, right, the direction. However, the tail part here, which increases the symbol interference, gets longer. So as the radius of the duct channel increases, duct system increases, and the cylindrical duct channel response becomes very similar to the pre-space channel response. And the effect of the different flow velocity profiles and Bézier flow, which will be introduced later, has a non-uniform velocity profile that depends on the liquid's characteristics and flow speed and ducts at the cross-section. So in a blood vessel or the other the molecular channel environment, and flow can also be categorized into two classes, namely turbulent flow and laminar flow. In particular, when the variation in the flow velocity or space and or the time those DSM variations are stochastic, for example, due to like very rough surfaces and very high flow velocities. And we refer to the flow as the turbulence. The turbulence is quite difficult to understand. I tried to read some papers to understand some diffusion mechanisms in the turbulence environment, but I don't think I fully understood that part either. So, because you know, even for the intrabody area, the networks, and we usually don't have the turbulence. So we focused on lamina flow. So if you know the flow is low, they're not turbulent, so we refer to as the lamina. So when we consider the blood vessels, and we could assume the same the channel. It could be it could be circle or other shapes like rectangle and triangle. Even for the surface, and we could assume full reflecting or semi-reflecting. For example, a permeable surface is considered for, you know, the capillary vessel. So that is the our classification. And then I'm sure you have heard about the Reynolds number in physics, I think, maybe in high school or in undergrad, the physics course. So let me just summarize that and remind that information. So Reynolds number can be used as a criterion for like the predicting lamina or turbulent flow. So for example, for a flow in a straight pipe with a circular cross section of the radius maybe AC here, and then the flow can be assumed to be lamina. And turbulent flow, and this kind of some thresholds. And if RE Reynolds number is smaller than 2000, and the lamina flow occurs. If the Reynolds number is greater than 2000, so we have the turbulent flow. So, you know, for the microfluidic settings, like our human body, typically, that's the Reynolds number is smaller than 10. So the lamina flow can be assumed. For most blood vessels, the Reynolds number is smaller than 500. Therefore, the blood flow is typically lamina as well. Only in large arteries, such as the aorta, that is the largest artery in our human body. So the Reynolds number can be in the range 3,400 to 4,500 or so. So therefore, the blood flow might have some turbulent behavior, but that's a very limited area, limited cases. So that's the one message. We should remember the Reynolds number only to see whether we have the turbulent flow or lamina flow. excuse me. So here, next question is that, how can you calculate the Reynolds number here for the flow in a bounded environment of the effective length, the effect, and the with an effective velocity of the fluid effect? This is given by this the equation here. RE is defined by here the several parameters, and rho is the density of the fluid, and U is the flow speed. R is the here R. This is not RE. The characteristic linear dimension. Mu is the dynamic viscosity. Nu is the kinematic viscosity. So once we have the all parameters and we can calculate that one, we can decide and we can see whether we have the turbulent or lamina. So, you know, the even the lamina flow is characterized by the fluid particles following the smooth path in layers, with each layer moving smoothly past the adjacent layers with the little or no mixing. That's a lamina plane wave, like the plane wave propagation in our communications. At this very low velocities, the fluid tends to the flow without lateral mixing, and the adjacent layer sides pass one another like the plane cart. So there are no cross currents perpendicular to the direction of the flow, nor eddies or swirls or of the fluid. In laminar flow, the motion of the particles of the fluid is very orderly, with particles close to a solid surface moving in straight lines parallel to that surface. So laminar flow is the flow rhythm characterized by high momentum diffusion and low momentum convection. So when a fluid is flowing through a closed channel, such as like a pipe or between two flat plates, either of two types of the flow may occur depending on the velocity and viscosity of the fluid, laminar flow or turbulent flow. So just the one more time, laminar flow occurs at low velocities and the turbulent occurs at the very high velocity. The velocity is determined by the dimensionless parameter characterizing the flow called the Reynolds number here, right? So the friction force between the tube surface and the liquid in ducts causes the non-uniform velocity profile. And in small ducts, such as the human blood vessels, and one cannot ignore this, the friction force. That is the thing. So for the constant uniform flow and the uniform the flow, like a space independent flow profiles, and the initial the concentration is simply translated to a different position without changing its shape. However, for here, Boiseau flow, which is the space-dependent flow profile, the concentration generally spreads in space over time, depending on the initial concentrations. So to achieve the uniform flow by the radial the diffusion in this time, which means after some long time, we don't observe this the velocity profile anymore. Also, the dispersion factor, it describes the relationship between flow and radial diffusion. So this is the system and the simulation setup for the uniform flow cases. So we consider a plane velocity profile. So here we released the chemical the molecules across this plane, and we have the uniform velocity. So that's why here we have some constant u regardless of the location here, and then we measure and we count the received molecules on this plane and the observing the receiver. So here we have some simulation results. Do we assume that the same flow speeds at all points, the same speed? And do we measure the positions at t equals 0 to 0.1 second, 0.2 second, 0.3 second, till 0.9 second? So the channel is fully reflecting 3D the circular pipe like here. You know, but you know the trend did not change over time. Due to the random movement, the random mechanism, it diffuses a bit, but we do not observe any velocity profile. Here, this is a line. This is kind of line at the end, at the surface, at the receiver, we will set the line. We only have some dispersion here as time goes by. This is because of the random movement, Brownian motion. So this simulation, we assume the dispersion factor is like almost 2.5 or so, which means we do not have that velocity profile. But as another important mechanism in vivo environment, the effect of the degradation reactions has not been analytically investigated for the discrete molecular communications in the cylindrical environment. So interestingly, the degradation reaction, this is chemical reaction, may be utilized to overcome intersymbol interference, and which is inspired from the living organisms. We also have this feature inside of our body. So by considering the more practical issues here, and we could re-derive the Chernow equations as shown in this slide. It's pretty long. I will skip the details, but the degradation part, the only contributes to the main flow direction. So as I mentioned earlier, when the dispersion factor is smaller than one, we have the Boissel flow. I don't know my pronunciation is correct. It's a French scientist, and it shows the parabolic velocity profile here at the radial axis, unlike the uniform flow. That's a big difference between the uniform flow and the Boissel flow. So this is another set of the simulations, Boissel flow, and still do we have the plane transmitter and plane observing receivers. But here we have much higher the velocity, and just because of some friction forces, and we have this kind of the parabolic shape of the velocity, the profile. So this is the another set of our simulations. You know, we release the messenger molecules evenly across the plane here. And as time goes by, that we can clearly observe the velocity profile here and here, even somewhere here. We obey the velocity profile, the parabolic shape. After a long time, the phenomenon is diluted, and which is pretty straightforward. So after maybe 1 second or 2 seconds, we do not have this kind of the velocity profile anymore. And in this simulation, we used the dispersion factor is about 0.3 or something like that. And, you know, I don't remember. It has the 1,000 micrometer per second or so. I don't remember the exact the speed number, but the obviously we have the different one, which means we have the quite different one, the system, the environment. Okay, and for more accurate channel modeling for the molecular communications in tubes with the Boissel flow, there's some researchers I remember, the guys from the Taiwan. Taiwanese have the derived probability density function of the axial displacement using Markov chain, and the approximated the flow velocity field. So here the equations are pretty ugly, but quite accurate. It also has a quite low computational complexity than the particle-based simulations. So the boundary conditions are also quite important, very important. We could consider various types of the cross-section for duct channel. Like most researchers, of course, have focused on the cylindrical shape. You know, we solve differential equations. And even for the free space cases, like a point transmitter and a cylindrical spherical, the observing receiver, it took like the 40 years to have the final Clausman expressions. In that case, we had somewhat little bit different initial conditions and a little bit different boundary conditions, but still in a free space. But when we derive some general characteristics for the cylindrical channel, it took quite long time. So it took like more than 1 year to analyze or analyzing and to have some expressions. And even we haven't tried to have rectangular shape boundary conditions because we didn't find any practical use cases for this system assumption. So again, the most prior work has assumed fully reflecting surface so far. This is enough for vein blood vessels, but not that accurate for capillary vessel. That's because the capillary has quite thin and permeable surface. So leakage on the surface decreases, of course, the amplitude of the sound signal here. So that is the no leakage, and it has the leakage on surface. And we could observe some big difference between the peak points of the two, the simulation widgets. So the receiving time is not also effective as much as the amplitudes. So we have some delay, but it has quite similar some numbers. But for the peak numbers, we have a big gap. So that is content for the channel. Let's start with some recent topic. So you know, the molecular communication is a new paradigm that does not have any RF components and RF technologies. However, the molecular communication is also a communication engineering, and it also has a similar communication problems. In the last few decades, to improve the link reliability and the system throughput, so we have extensively studied topics like multiple input, multiple output, which is MIMO, and full duplex communications and relay communications. In the previous class, I introduced the macroscale tabletop test beds. So is there anyone who could guess the transmission rate, data rate for one? We got the question I mentioned last week. The errors can occur over the channel in molecular communication. Is there an error correcting code to fix the errors? Sure, of course, we have the noble channel correction code as well. And I will also introduce that part. I also have some slides for that. So let me get back to my question. Is there anyone who could guess there's some weird number, data transmission rate for a test bed? Several kilobytes. Wow, you have so big number. Do you think that we have the kilobyte speed per second? So, you know, it was like the approximately the 1 bit per second, which is way lower than the RF communications. I'm not joking here. It's 1 bit second. So, to transmit, the six alphabets, we use the about 30 bits, right? I mentioned RTA2, the encoding structure. So we need the at least 5 bits to represent the one single alphabet. So which means just to send the 6 alphabets, it took about the 30 seconds. Eventually, the main challenge in the molecular communication is expected to be the technology implementation with higher data rate and lower, higher data rates, and also lower the error rate. So the particle movement here, do we rely on the diffusion and drift, and the quantifying data rate is a limiting factor for implementing the molecular communication protocol. So in light the RF communications, the standard strategies to achieve an enhanced data rate is to obtain an extra degree of freedom from the domains of the sometimes power or time or frequency or and space. So same strategy has also been used in this domain, molecular communications. Of course, molecular type can be added on behalf of the frequency and an exclusive domain for the waves. So second one, the full duplex here. So we could also have the two-way communications by mitigating the self-interference. So in the RF communications, we had half duplex, like the time division duplex or frequency division duplex. So we still have the here full duplex to achieve up to theoretically double throughputs just by using like the two-way some of the approaches. You know, I remember the Elif you asked yesterday, the short communication distance is another technical hurdle that we could attack. So relay concept, they can also be a solution for this problem. And each technique has the pros and cons. So let's study in more detail. All right. So, you know, like what we have discussed, the spatial domain can be obtained by applying the MIMO configurations. One might argue that the MIMO may not work in the diffusion environment because of the totally different channel characteristics. And you know, the coherence time is jitter. So at the receiver side, we cannot use the real-time instantaneous channel state information. But we propose noble detection algorithms for this the molecular communication with the 2x2 configurations, and we implemented a test bed. So let's watch the demo video first.
As sly as a fox,
you know, we have the brown emotion.
As fast as a hare, as brave as a bear, as free as a bird, as neat as a word, as quiet as a mouse, as big as a house.
Before real chip the jitter 0.28, but it depends on the distance. If we have the longer distance, of course the data rate drops a lot.
As sharp as a tooth, as deep as a bite, as dark as the night, as sweet as a song, as right as a wrong, as long as a road, as ugly as a toad, as pretty as a picture hanging from a big jar, strong like a family.
So we achieved the 1.7 times a higher data rate compared to the CISO case. And also we implemented, you know, the test bed. We had the similar transmit part using the Arduino controller. still, we want to transmit 6 alphabet YONSEI. Yeah, that is our transmitter. We implemented everything.
As long as the sun, as silly as fun, as cool as a tree, as scary as the sea, as hot as fire, cold as ice, sweet as
you can see the some. More liquors, right?
As buzzed as a bee, as stealth as a tiger, as smooth as a glider, pure as a melody, pure as I wanna be.
So here we have the two screens because we have the two receivers, and then we finally and successfully receive the 6 alphabet YONSEI here into almost half time of the size of case. So the in our communications, the multiple antennas are expected to bring, you know, the performance benefits in 3 ways. I think we all know the array gain, diversity gain, and multiplexing gain. So array gain is the advantage of a high SNR at the receiver and can be achieved by the coherently adding received signal at the antennas. A transmitter is required to have the some channel state information for the signal coherence. The diverse gain offers a lower error rates, thus by securing the independent channel paths and reducing the fading effect. And then the correlation status between the antennas needs to be known to exploit the real diversity of the gain. In contrast, the multiplexing gain achieve an increase in the data rate by using simultaneous data streams via pairs of the transmitter and receiver antennas. So this technique is also referred to as the spatial multiplexing, and the MIMO technologies could succeed in conventional communications with the studies on the channel model, the signal coherence, and antenna correlations. In the molecular communications, the standard channel model is in its still the development stage, and a diffusion-dominated environment makes it difficult to achieve the coherence. So, you know, the coherence time is practically zero. So to the best of our knowledge, the spatial correlation between diffusive channel has not been performed yet. So the channel interference detection of the verification and prerequisites to applying the MIMO schemes to the molecular communications. So here we have some challenges like what I mentioned here. So the MIMO system here, MIMO system model, I am considering is the illustrated in this slide, which shows that transmitter and receiver are equipped with the multiple antennas. By the way, as I mentioned yesterday, there are not really practical physical antennas. It's like the chemical transmitters and chemical receivers. So we based our discussions on a 2x2 with the symmetric configurations. And the transmitter antennas are here regarded as the point sources that release the messenger molecules, messenger particles into the channel medium. The receiving antennas are here again spherical in shape for analytical tractability. So these antennas observe the contacted molecules and count their number over time. Besides the statistical, there's some counting noise, the additional Gaussian noise. So we assume the Gaussian noise to buffer the system from the unexpected burst events. So it is also assumed that the transceivers are perfectly synchronized with one another and they are aware of the predefined system parameters, like including the required CSI and symbol time. So we have these three models of the interest, the three dimensional free space, and the bounded space, and undefined channel model. In the free space channel model, the molecules propagate through diffusion and drift, and diffusion dynamics have the indeterminacy of the exact the movements. And long-term analysis is the best way to address this. That's why we rely on long-term characteristics like PDF or like the expected numbers of the received molecules. So in this condition, the channel that the information carriers experience at the channel is the expected value. So in the minimum configurations, molecular absorption at one receiver antenna induces the dependency on the others. And then finding the closed form solution remains still the open problem. You know, there are so many open problems in this area. So that's why I welcome to this area. And you guys can have a really big impact if you like those kind of research. So we revealed that it's possible to closely approximate the MIMO channel model just by tuning some parameters on top of the size of solution. This is why we need some tuning or some fitting or some machine learning techniques as well. The channel state information required for the transmitter in this model compromise the drift velocity, the diffusion coefficient, distance, and MIMO parameters. So the requirement of the retuning parameters for the varying topologies makes the system very sensitive to the displacement of the communication units. When the parameters are unknown, the machine learning-based parameter tuning, like what I mentioned just before, and so that we manage to adjust the parameters given the communication distance within a range of the some training and data. Also, the like in RF communications, we could also use the spatial modulation by using like on of king across the some antennas here in the analog antenna domain. So the number of passes that we can have with like a T transmit antennas and the number of effective receive antennas here is bounded up to the R, or is the T multiplied by the effective number of antennas and down to one, where the value is the commensurate with the receiver antenna correlation. So the molecular communication channel decays over a distance by a power of 3. It's a different from the Friis model in the being widely used in RF communications. So therefore, it is very sensitive to the physical separation. So physical separation is very important. So the alignment can also affect the effectiveness of the receiver. So because the antenna absorbs molecules, the wrong alignment can affect some of the antennas. So the receiver, the effectiveness can also be enhanced further just by having a transmitter antenna directivity. The number of effective transmitter antenna also depends on the correlation. But MIMO so far, I just gave you some good points for the MIMO, but MIMO has some drawbacks as well. We assumed when we designed the algorithm, we assumed the isotropic propagation from the transmitter. This causes interference to the undesired RX antennas, like here, interlink interference. So for this, it would be good to have line of sight MIMO that we are considering for 6G, for sub-terahertz or millimeter wave spectrum, but due to the nature of the diffusion mechanism, we have quite non-negligible the interlink interference is the red color. Therefore, we need some novel signal separation and distance estimation techniques. The main difference in designing MIMO detection algorithms from CISO is the presence of the multiple streams and the absence of the the exacta model, for example, in pursuing the multiplexing game, and we assume that the transceiver antennas pair and handle the ILR by just considering that as the additional noise. So this model is feasible under the condition of antenna pairing in the aligned topology. So problem needs to be addressed to mitigate interlink interference when the configuration is not aligned and where interlink interference can exceed the primary signal. So after the obtaining the best degree of freedom, we can achieve the performance gain by applying MIMO strategies. So here, Thomas Martin from Germany, he reported the array gain is achievable just by adding coding and receiver combining techniques with some appropriate detection algorithms, including like a thresholding, finding, and learning-based algorithms. So they, including myself here, they proposed that the Alamouti type codes or repetitive code benefits the system and weighted combining of the signals at the receiving antennas, they introduced the array gain of the almost 3 with 2x2 MIMO. 3 is like a double. They're very similar to the RF communications. So their results indicate that it is feasible to exploit degree of freedom for diversity gain in the multi molecular communication MIMO. And also, you know, we got those numbers and graph from these papers, and we also achieved the multiplexing gain here, and with the much lower power, and we achieved almost it should be multiplexing gain. We achieved the points up to 1.9 times higher throughputs with higher than all the values. So next, the best technique is full duplex. So most prior work I have shown so far assumed the one-way molecular communication system. Here, the molecules are transmitted in one direction from the transmitter to the receiver. While this simplifies the design, and recent work in full duplex radio communication indicates the data rate gains along with other performance advantages may be obtained from the two-way communications. So here, we propose the two-way system that uses a single type of molecule. So here, we have the single type of molecule for the link for the forward link and reverse link. That's why we have the quite severe self-interference cancellation. So if each of the directional, the communication link uses maybe a different type of molecule, then self-interference would not occur. However, this is not a feasible solution. This would not be a feasible solution. First, the nano devices are too simple to perform complex tasks. The second, the number of molecular types will increase rapidly on the order of like the if we increase the some modulation order. In the half duplex system, it's paired the transmitter, the operates alternately with respect to the time deviant duplex. When we release certain amount of the molecules for the forward link, and then the receiver does not act anything. He just is ready to receive the molecules coming from this transmitter. However, the analytical modeling of such a system is not that too difficult. To observing spheres or to use a single type of molecules, but unfortunately, to implement the simultaneous communication between two nanomachines, nanodevices, we cannot use previous studies on molecular communication channel model. As such, studies assume the one-way molecular communication with a single observing receiver. Therefore, in this paper, we derive, we analytically, the model, the molecular received the signal in the case of the two observing spheres and propose the self-interference cancellation techniques and analyze the proposed system's performance in terms of the bit error rate and throughputs. I won't explain the details here, but you can also find our contribution in the paper. It was published in 2019. So I believe this is the theoretical groundbreaking work, like RF for duplex radios. We could use analog passive cancellation, analog active cancellation, and also the digital cancellation. So to reduce the self interference at the transmitter, the emission point is physically separated from the reception port. Also, the transmitter is aware of its own antenna profile, like the one and so on. So we use the long-term characteristics of the self-signal response. And as you could guess, there is a trade-off. The longer the antenna, the bigger the occupancy of the machine. So reducing the size of the nanomachine causes the severe, the intersymbol, the interference. So for the fair comparison, fair performance comparisons, so we have to compare the throughputs of the half duplex and full duplex. As can be seen here, just the regardless of the symbol in tower TS, the full duplex shows the approximately the double throughput performance. Here, the symbol in tower for the half duplex, of course, half of the data of the full duplex. So the concentration of the molecules forced with a distance, right, which makes the communication to the far nodes nearly impossible. So we all now understand this issue. So in order to elevate this problem, and some researchers proposed use a molecular relay node. It's quite straightforward, right? The relay node can resend the messenger, the messages, the either the by the different or the same type of molecules as the original signal from the transmitter. So it's not my paper. Some authors studied two scenarios of the relay. In the first scenario, the relay node simply senses the received concentration and forwarded it to the receiver. So they show that this sense and forward scenario, depending on the type of molecules used for the relay, it results in either increasing the range of the concentration of the molecules at the receiver or increasing the effective number of molecules in the receiver node, which means we increase the receive this and all just by adding some relay nodes. For both cases of the sense and forward relay, they obtain the resulting, they obtain the quite nice improvement result in channel capacity. So they also conducted that multi-type molecular relay, they outperforms the single-type relay. And in the second scenario, they also studied the decode and forward the type relay for memory signaling. Most work on this topic is analogous to the RF communications.